a big difference between tactics and theory. Us engineers don't live in a bubble. Everything we do with the fire service. Practical applications must be developed by your department. If you have two guys on the first responding rig, if you've got six guys on the first responding rig, you've got small houses, big houses, all of these differences are extremely important, and we're going to talk about those differences. Engineers don't have all the answers, regardless of what some people might think when they read the first sentence of a report. We can't test every possible configuration, but we can begin to bound the problem. And that's where we're going to go. We're going to talk about variables to give you the right information. There aren't enough fires to make you an expert, so we need research to bridge the gap. It would be awful freaking cool if you could respond to a house fire, pick a set of tactics. All right, this one, I'm going through the front door, hitting that fire in the CD corner, we're going home, and I'll vent that window and throw this fan up and cut a hole in the roof. All right, well, that went pretty well. All right, but this time, I'm going to rewind the tape. We're going to go back 2 hours. We're going to go back to the firehouse. We're going to do it again. Everything is exactly the same, except I'm going to pick a different tactic this time. You don't get that luxury. We can do that in research. We can only change one thing so we can understand the impact of that one thing. We want to make sure that you guys aren't guessing on the fire ground because you aren't quite sure what to do or what impact you're going to have on that fire. So as we go through this, I'm kind of taking feedback that I've heard from people around. And if at any point you hear never ventilate, never go inside, always throw water from the outside, never go over a basement fire, never vertically vent, everything you did in the past is wrong. If you hear any of those things at any point, listen harder. That is not what I'm saying at all. Hear the whole picture. Let's talk about the changing fire environment. Look at this, I tricked you into a formula. Silly engineer. Larger homes, open spaces, evolving fuel loads, more void spaces, changing building materials and new technologies. This stuff is coming at you from all different angles. It's not just one thing that's changing, your whole fire environment is changing. Every one of these poses different problems for you, and when you start combining them, they're creating problems that we don't maybe even quite understand yet. One thing for sure, we're seeing faster fire propagation, shorter times to flash over, rapid changes in fire dynamics, shorter escape times, shorter times to collapse, and unknown hazards. Solar panels. A huge project on solar panels. There were hazards there that I would never even have thought of until we got into that project.
Steve Kerber at UL set up this very good demonstration, this good experiment. Legacy fuel and modern fuel. I'm sure most of you in the room have already seen the demonstration where he did it in a flashover cell. And this is the beauty of this business, because then I call Steve and I say, Steve, you know, that's a flashover cell. That's not a house. Right? Might perform differently in a house. So Steve says, I'm going to build some houses. We'll see what it does. So the legacy fuel is basically sofas. The cushions are made of down, natural material. The back of the sofa has cotton in it. There may be some wool in there, some kapok in the Target sofa. They're all natural fibers. The modern fuel, however, is made of polyurethane foam, polyesters, right? And what do we see in the modern fuel? Inside, it's darkened down already, right? That home is full of smoke top to bottom. What's that doing for the occupants? Not good. What do you notice with grandma's furniture, or maybe great-grandma's furniture at this point in time? Now, the smoke layer is still developing. We're still in the early growth stage of the fire. We're in that incipient stage of the fire. They just vented. What's happening in the modern fuel side once they vented? They've now reintroduced additional oxygen, and that's going to allow that fire to quickly transition to flash over. What's going on with the old fuel? We're still in the growth stage. We haven't got ventilation limited yet. We haven't gone into that early decay stage. So the fire keeps going. So basically the way the experiment's being run is we're waiting for the legacy fuel to get ventilation limited, get oxygen depleted, be fuel rich, all the same kind of terminology. They mean the same thing. And then they're going to vent it. So we're waiting for it to darken down. And even though this video is sped up in the interest of time, it seems like we're watching paint drying, doesn't it? Well, what the difference is Granddad had more time. So if he opened the door or did some other action, the fire was more forgiving. The new fire is so fuel rich. The house is storing so much energy. There's bigger compartments. It's not as forgiving. Right? So you don't have that luxury of time. Now it's getting darkened down. They're getting ready to vent the legacy. They open the door. They take the window. It's not flashed over yet. It's going to. But again, it takes it a little more time to build that heat release rate to get to the point where it can flash over the room. You see the layer building. You see the unburned fuels filling that space. They're going to get hot enough to ignite, basically for the conditions for the fire triangle to get those gases burning. And then fully developed, full flashover. Look at the times. It took four times as long to become ventilation limited in this demonstration with the older fuel as it did with the modern fuel. Then from the time to ventilation to flashover, the legacy fuels, the natural fuels, over 8 minutes. The time for ventilation to flashover, 2 minutes. How fast does that time go by when you're on the fire ground, trying to get hoses moved, trying to get people organized, trying to get things going?
Graphs I'm going to show you, because I think there's some really neat differences here. The blue temperature is the modern temperature in the living room. It hits 1100 degrees Fahrenheit before it runs out of oxygen, versus the legacy only hits about 400 or a little more than 400 before it runs out of oxygen. It dies down. We drop from 1100 degrees down to 400 degrees. And then we ventilate and we go back up to 1800 degrees. Over here, we ventilate, it drops to about 250, it chugs along, it's trying, and it finally hits flashover. We're at about 1600 degrees. So when you start talking about, well, fires are hotter today, temperature-wise, well, maybe. I mean, this says it might be true, 1800 degrees instead of 1600 degrees. Does that really matter to you? Absolutely not. It's how quickly it gets there. Here we're getting there in 2 minutes, here we're getting there in 8.5 minutes. Look at the oxygen concentrations. We drop to 5% before we recover. And then when we're involved, we drop to 2%. Legacy, we're running out of oxygen, we're still in the 18% ballpark, not the 5% ballpark. Our pendulum isn't swinging so fast that it overshoots and swings back. So the responsiveness to that oxygen is going to be very different because of the oxygen concentrations we're dealing with. So here, this pretty much sums up the workplace. Houses are getting smaller, lots are getting, or houses are getting bigger, lots are getting smaller, fuel loads are changing, layouts are changing, building materials are changing. Have your staffing, training, tactics changed to adapt to these changes? Doesn't need an answer. Think about it. You all have a different answer to that question, probably. You have a room like this out in the open. This is what your fire growth curve looks like. Ignition, growth, fully developed, decay. That's really what we're doing in our firefighter training buildings. We can't do this in our firefighter training buildings, where you get growth, then you get a decay stage, then there's a ventilation, and then you get growth, and then it's fully developed, and then you get decay. That's what happens when you take this and put it in a structure and ventilate the structure. This is even too simple. Here's a fire growth curve where two things happen. The front door gets open and a hole gets cut in the roof. It's important to know that there isn't one growth stage. There isn't one decay stage. There isn't one fully developed stage. Don't get thrown off by all this stuff. It's actually pretty simple. The fire ignites. It grows. At some point, it transitions from a fuel-limited fire to a ventilation-limited fire. As it makes that transition, it's running out of oxygen, and then you get your first decay stage, or your initial decay stage. From this point on, we're ventilation-limited. We're now producing more fuel than we have oxygen to burn. We get our initial decay. An event takes place. That event happens to be ventilation. In this case, we open the front door. Then we get a second growth stage. At some point during that growth stage is flashover. Flashover is not a stage of fire growth. It's an event. It's a momentary event that takes place during that growth stage, and that growth stage continues. At some point, when we've got fire completely coming out of that front door, and that flow path only exists at the front door, you got flames coming out of the front door, you see air going in low, flames coming out of the top, it's burning there because it ran out of oxygen, and that's the only place it can find the oxygen. That's fully developed. It can't get any bigger. It's responded to the oxygen, it hit a peak. So now we're in our first fully developed stage. So the fire isn't vented, it's venting. You give it more air. In this case, we vent the roof. We get another growth stage. More fire, more energy is being produced. And then once we've got fire coming out of the front door and fire coming out of the roof, we hit a fully developed stage again. So we've got a new fully developed stage that is above the other fully developed stage because we're burning more now. And then we go ahead and we hit it with some water, and then we get to the decay stage. What would happen if we went ahead and took that window out after we made the roof vent? We'd come up again, another growth stage, another fully developed stage, until we get water on it, or we run out of fuel, one or two, and then we get to the decay stage. I think we have a lot of folks out there that believe when the fire's showing from the structure, it's vented, we're all good. It's coming out. Well, you're all good because you know where it is. But if you keep making openings to a ventilation-limited fire, you will keep having fire coming out of the openings.
Flow path. Be hearing a lot about this word. So this definition is now going into the ventilation bulletin for the FDNY so that people can understand flow path. So what we have there is a fire room that's colored orange. We have an air inlet. Then we go down a hallway. We go to a living room. And then you see the red arrow, hot, blue is cool, going to an outlet.
So flow path. What is a flow path? this is based on a definition that FDNY is adopting. We understand the final bulletin is going to go out in May. A flow path is the volume between an inlet and an outlet that allows the movement of heat and smoke. So very simple terms, this is our flow path. Okay? This is our inlet with the blue, the cool area. It goes through the fire. The fire acts as a pump. This pump actually does a couple of things. Not only does it move the product, but it also adds mass to it in the form of combustion products, and it adds energy to it, right? And then it pumps it out. So we have this lower density, higher pressure gas that's going out in this hot layer. So this is the exhaust. So inlet, exhaust. The place where you do not want to be is in the exhaust. Here's another view, sort of showing a flow path. So again, we're going to talk about different building configurations. Flow paths can get pretty complicated in a big building. And many times, firefighters' actions can make them more complicated. So if you go through a building and do your search and keep leaving doors open or start taking every window as you go, you're making more opportunities for an exhaust if the fire's still active. Front door is ventilation. Here's another one that we've overlooked for some time. Do we teach fire behavior with forcible entry? Probably almost never. However, a doorway is the best possible way to ventilate a ventilation-limited fire. It goes all the way to the ground, which is ideal. So your air can go in low and some hot gases can come out high. It's one of the most efficient ways we have to grow a fire. So if you've got a ventilation limited fire, which we had in the one-story house and the two-story house, from the moment the front vent gets open until flashover, you're looking at like 60 seconds to 2.5 minutes, depending on a couple variables, just by opening the front door. Do we ever show up, chop the front door open before the hose line's ready to go? All the time. Do we show up as chiefs, want to see what conditions we have, pop the front door, and leave it open? Of course we do. Do we have cops that get that front door open all the time before we get there because they happen to be around the corner? Do we get neighbors that find ways to get doors open? Absolutely. Best way to grow a fire. Who knows how long that door's been open? Maybe the occupant left it open. Maybe they forced it open. The fire's not going to wait for you to get your line together and get your mask on. It's going to respond to that oxygen. Oh, we'll leave that. Never mind. So what if we were to control the front door? We always don't have front door, there's the fire. It's not always that easy. Sometimes you've got to advance into the structure to go ahead and put the fire out. If you can delay the chance that it becomes a race between how fast you can get in there and how fast the air can get in there, if you're not really tight with your 90 seconds, you want to do everything you can to limit the oxygen going in through that front door. So even if you have a hose line going in through that front door, straight in, and you still leave the door open about a foot and a half, that two-thirds that you're blocking that opening has a really positive impact on slowing that fire growth down. Kind of gives you yourself a little bit of a buffer. Here's what that looks like. The one on the left, we force it all the way open, allow the hose crew to go in, and then we pull it closed so it's only open so a 2-inch line can go straight through the front door. The one on the right, we just kick it all the way open.
gap on the door on the left?
Gap on the door is about a foot and a half.
Same fire loads.
Same fire load, everything else is identical. So what does that look like? Well, we also combined this with a vertical ventilation test. The way we triggered vertical ventilation was as soon as we hit 400 degrees Fahrenheit at 3 feet, at your head where it would be extremely hot. So what we saw, from the door wide open to the door control, there was about a 3 minute lag in reaching 400 degrees at 3 feet. That's an extra 3 minutes of getting water on that fire. In the two-story, we've got a fire in the back of the house, so the door is further away from where the fire is. Longer flow path for that air to take to get to the fire. We thought the fire was going to go out when we controlled the door. Versus wide open, we went 400 degrees in about 12 minutes, versus leaving the door controlled, thought the fire was going to put itself out. So we wound up opening it all the way to continue to grow it so we could do the vertical ventilation piece of the test. Door control is a temporary action. I recommend, whoever the guy is you have at the front door pinch point, advancing line, as one hand on the doorknob controlling the door, and the other hand is feeding line into the crew. Any little bit, whether it's half or two-thirds or whatever, that he's stopping that oxygen from going in through that front door, he's buying that crew time to put water on the fire. Once water gets on the fire, open the door. That's when you're winning the battle. It's all about winning the battle. The fire's going to create a certain amount of energy. If you're taking away more energy with your hose line than that fire is creating, vent your heart out. Open it up, you've won the battle, the smoke will lift. If that fire is producing more energy than you're taking away and you ventilate, conditions will get worse. It's all about that heat release rate. It's all about that ventilation limit. Door control is not only for hose line advancement. I'm not suggesting you search ahead of the hose line, but if you have to, and I understand there's conditions where you may have to, my kid is in that room right there, and you're going to go by way of the interior, one of the best things you can possibly do is control that door behind you. That way it's not a race. If you can buy yourself 3 extra minutes or more to get that victim and get them out before it flashes on you because you don't have any means to slow it down, because you don't have a hose line, this is a tool to consider. It's not only for the front door. You're moving your way through a house. Every door that you can control, you can cut yourself off from the flow path and buy yourself plenty of time to search the area you're in. Or if things go to shit on you, and you need to get out, and you can get between where the fire is and a closed door, you're going to buy yourself all kinds of time because you're not the flow path anymore. People get concerned about the door relatching and things like that after you force it. Use a tool. If it's only open a little bit, you're doing a heck of a lot of good. Rate of change. This is one thing that we saw over and over again. We've seen it in my tests, we've seen it in Governor's Island, we've seen it in Spartansburg, we've seen it all over the place. It's a constant that keeps happening. You get this lull period where the fresh air enters and it mixes with the ventilation limited conditions that are in that house. And the moment things start to go bad, they go bad in an absolute hurry. We're talking from 100 degrees to 2,000 degrees in 10 seconds. Gets bad really fast. Betting near the seat of the fire versus far from the seat of the fire. Again, it all comes down to flow paths. The closer you vent to the seat of the fire, the faster that fire will grow. The faster faster you provide that oxygen to the fire, the faster it will grow. The closer you vent to the seat of the fire, and the faster you put water on the fire, the faster you let the heat out. So in our books, when it says vent near the seat of the fire, the reason it's saying that is because it's assuming that you're controlling the fire with water. That's when you want to let the hot stuff out as quickly as possible, the nearest you can to the seat of the fire. Venting far from the seat of the fire. If you want to spread the fire to a different part of the structure, provide that as a flow path. Vent that back window. Eventually, this fire will go back this way because fire is nothing more than pressure phenomenon. It's going to flow from a higher pressure to a lower pressure. The moment you give it the low pressure in the back of the house, it's going to take longer for this fire to go to flashover if you vent back here, because that fresh air needs to make it all the way into here, and as it's making it into here, it's got the hot gases going out over top of it. At that interface, they're kind of mixing together. So you're not exactly getting 21% oxygen right away into this fire. It's mixing. You might get 19, 18, 17% in here. It doesn't grow as fast. But when you vent right at that seat of the fire, that's where you're getting your 60-second, 90-second, 120-second flashover times. You're giving it right where it wants it. But if we put water on it before we get to those time frames, then it goes out and the heat leaves. And you do exactly what your ventilation was intended to do. You've got to coordinate it. Reading smoke. I gave you a quick glimpse of this earlier. Ventilation limited fire. It's pushing out. Every little crack that it can find around our window plugs, around our doorway. It's going to start changing from gray to white. So if we're reading colors, we might be getting some mixed messages. And we lose a lot of our visual cues. How many people have responded to smoke in the area, found smoke in the area, had a house on fire, but the house on fire really didn't have much showing whatsoever?
And too lately.
Too lately. So it's... The other piece of this, because the attic space is vented, a lot of times you might get lazy smoke coming out of the eaves or out of the roof line. That's because that is not... It's an open space, so if smoke leaks into the attic space, it's continue to slowly leak out because of the ventilation in the attic space. So you might only have smoke showing from the eave line. Doesn't automatically mean you have an attic fire. It means probably you have a ventilation limited fire in the living space. When you pop the front door, this is probably the best insight you have to what's going on. Pay a lot of attention when you pop that front door. If you get smoke pulling in past you low, and fresh air going in at about 10 to 15 miles per hour, you have a ventilation limited fire. Fire acts like a pump. It pulls fresh air, pushes out hot gases. That fire is ventilation limited, the faster it's going to pull that air in. So if for some reason you're thinking, all right, I'm searching ahead of the hose line on this one, and that front door gets popped, and it starts pulling in, probably want to think of either that's not the fire to do that on, or get some door control going. It also tells you a lot about potentially what the level of the fire is. Because, again, the fire is a pump. It wants to create a neutral plane. So if you pop that front door and the smoke stays at the ground, you might have a basement fire. You pop that front door and the smoke lifts and makes a tunnel right here, you probably have fire on the first floor. If you pop that front door and you've got smoke filling your front door that immediately lifts to the top of the doorway, the fire is probably above you. A lot you can learn from that front door. But again, you've got to watch for a second and slow yourself down and read the conditions. You can't just pop it and go running right through the front door. If this is a good indication of what's going on, take the second to look at it. The other thing you're going to notice is, with the fire being a pump, and it starts recirculating smoke and creating a tunnel, that airflow is going to where the fire is. You have a charged hose line and you're ready to go. It's leading you right to the scene of the fire in many cases. The other thing you need to realize is, this is just creating a tunnel between you and where the fire is in some cases. It's not lifting the smoke in the rest of the house. The back rooms don't have smoke that automatically lifts up off the floor. This is also temporary. As that pulls in, as soon as that oxygen mixes with that fire, you're now losing the battle again. It's creating more energy and more smoke than you're letting out. So if you go ahead and start to ride that tunnel in, and you don't get to the scene of the fire, you're going to lose your visibility and your tunnel's going to go away and you're going to black out on you. Then the question is, what's going to win? The amount of fire coming over your head to go to the low pressure of that flow path, or your water moving in to knock that fire down? One of the more reasons that you need to be controlling the fire from the moment that you go through that front door. One of the things that I like is, how many old guys in here, how many younger guys have been told by the old guys, I want an ear exposed, I want a wrist exposed, I want something exposed so I can get an idea of what the conditions are. Well, I don't want to give up a piece of my body, but I've got a tool that I can use to get an idea of what the conditions are. It's called water. Shoot water ahead of you up into the hot gas layer. If it turns to steam, what do we know? It's over 212 degrees and it's doing work for you. It's taking energy away. You throw water up ahead of you, all falls to the ground, no steam. It's less than 212 degrees, I can keep moving. You also have a 40 or 50 foot reach of your hose string. I can hit almost every piece of this first floor from within the first 10 feet of that front doorway. I can get a really good indication of what part of the house is making steam and what part isn't by sweeping my hose line across that floor. Coordination. I've harped on this enough. It's extremely important that we coordinate our ventilation with our fire suppression. You have to ventilate. However, it can't be alone. You aren't going to control a fire purely by ventilating alone. The amount of energy that you're going to allow to be increased, you need to take away with that hose string. Vent enter search, and then what I've gotten beat up and ridiculed about and everything else is you add the word isolate in there, and all of a sudden you're a horrible person. You learn real quickly by traveling the country that a whole lot of people weren't even considering closing that door, while many others say, I've been closing that door forever. You've got to isolate the flow path.
Impact the door control. George shared a lot of passion about door control. What we're going to do in this experiment is we're going to go ahead, start with the front door closed, allow the fire to grow, allow it to run out of air. Once it runs out of air, we're going to go ahead and open the front door, provide it some oxygen. Then we're going to go ahead and we're going to close the front door again, cut that oxygen supply off. Then we're going to go ahead and give it oxygen again. And you're going to see what's going to happen with the temperatures throughout the structure purely by playing with the front door. Fire again is in the living room on the first floor. Got a flow path through the second floor and out the back. Living room goes to flashover. Front door gets closed. Main source of oxygen coming in low to grow that fire to let the hot gases out the top. See the smoke color changes.
Conditions in the bedroom on the second floor change. So it's not only your actions near the fire that are having a huge impact, or the conditions on victims that may be remote from where you are. The simple act of closing the front door can have a huge impact on everything going on in that structure. When the images go blue, that's just Dan and I burning up another high-dollar camera so we can give you a view. When you start seeing the thermal imaging cameras start getting distorting, that's where we start getting a little bit nervous. If the head technician, Roy, he's got a row of charcoal briquette thermal imaging cameras on his desk so that way you keep his trophies. So what happened? Look at the top of the stairs. Look at the area leading from where the fire is to where the victims may be on the second floor bedrooms. Once the door gets closed, you drop the temperature almost in half at the top of the stairs, from 500 degrees down to 250 degrees. Heat rises, right? Well, when you cut off the source of the oxygen, and that fire cannot produce the energy, it can't produce the heat. Temperature is nothing but an end result of the energy. As soon as you knock that fire back by cutting off its oxygen supply, 500 to 250. We open the door, 250 to 750. And again, we're talking about the door being open for about 20 seconds. We're increasing the temperature at the top of the stairs, 500 degrees. We close the door again, it goes from 750 to 450. Open it, 450 to 900. Close it again, 900 down to 500. Look at the bedroom temperatures. We're making huge swings by doing nothing but opening and closing the front door. So when you start talking about being ready to start your attack, having that charged hose line ready to go, that charged hose line isn't ready to go. When you open that front door, you're sending those top of stair temperatures from 250 to 750 while you're waiting for that line to get in place. Keep them at 250 until you're ready to take energy away from that fire with your hose line. And have a huge impact. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Steve. Thanks, Dan. All right, so George and Dan really did a great job of setting the stage. Now we get to the fun part. I promise no more graphs. That's it for the graphs. Everything from now on, we're going to start looking at tactical considerations. And again, look at that term, tactical consideration. Figure how it may or may not fit into your operations, how it may or may not fit in with your staffing. Wrap your head around it. Think about it a little bit. We're going to give you videos to show you the visual comparison, and then we're going to throw some figures up to give you an idea of what was happening with the numbers. What would happen depending on where you were? What would happen with where the victims were? What you're looking at is a fire on the first floor, and now you're looking at a window. The closed bedroom window got taken out first. The open bedroom window got taken out second. So if you're conducting a vent, enter, isolate search operation, that's what you're crawling into with that open bedroom on the second floor with the door open, and you're going to watch what happens as that door gets closed. So as that isolate takes place, watch how conditions change. Your flow out of that window drops to essentially zero. All of the smoke that's in that room, you've now cut off the source of the fire. The smoke is going to lift. You're going to gain visibility, and for any potential occupant that may have been in that room, you're now improving conditions for them to go ahead, conduct that search. God forbid you find somebody, it gives you the time to get them out. So what's that look like? Well, we boiled down all the million data points, and we looked at the key locations within the structure. And the key takeaway here is that you must control that door. If you don't control that door, as you can see, you're at about a 15 mile per hour flow. You can't run that fast, let alone get out a window and get onto a ladder. Look at the temperature changes. The bottom of the stairs take off with that flow path in place. Once that's opened, that window gets broken, you're looking at temperatures at the top of the stairs that are going from 350 degrees to 950 degrees in very short order. You're looking in that closed bedroom, goes up a little bit as the hot gases seep around the cracks. In the open bedroom, you're going from 350 degrees to up over 600 degrees at the ceiling, 170 to 290 at the floor. You're not doing anybody in that room a favor by putting them in the flow path. All right, what happens once you isolate that door? Once you isolate that door in that open bedroom, you drop the ceiling temperature from 450 to 150. Temperatures of the floor go from 170 to 120. Most importantly, you cut off that flow, make it zero. Now you have a place where you can operate and get someone out of that location. And this is a situation that's extremely remote from where that fire started. That fire started in the living room in the back of the house, had to travel to the front of the house, go up the stairwell, and then travel to the bedrooms in the back of the house.
So this is firefighter Rob Weedman in the window. I'm sure most people have seen the video. They got a 911 call. A lady had been gone from her house for about 45 minutes. Her husband went to work, and then she took her children to school. She came back, and she heard the smoke alarm going off. She opened the front door. She went up the stairs a little bit, saw plenty of smoke upstairs, came back down. Front door remained open, and basically she was calling 911 from the foyer, keeping the door open. That ended up getting transmitted as someone trapped in the house, as she was calling from in the house. When they arrived on scene, they did talk to her, but they started to go ahead of the hose line and started to make a search. So what they didn't know was that the rear of the house, the windows had already vented, and there were flames going out the rear of the house. And then they broke these windows, and Rob then broke this window to get out. The ladder company was already on the roof. That's what this was doing there, and they had vented a number of skylights. So in the space of about a minute, we've got the front windows vented, or two of the front windows vented, and the skylights and the scuttle vented on the roof. So here's the front of the house. Here's the rear of the house where the fire had extended out of the rear windows. Here's the floor plan. So yesterday in the talk, they talked about a railroad flat. This is what a railroad flat looks like. The fire started in the rear. Basically, a curling iron was left in got knocked into a pile of clothes. And over that 45-minute period that the mom was gone, it had burned pretty well in this rear bedroom, failed the ceiling, and was up into the joists in the roof. The two windows were out. There's only thin glass doors between this room and this room. There's a hollow core door between this room and that room, and there's just a big open doorway between this bedroom and this bedroom. So the only entrance to the hallway is here and here. This is the stairs, this is the hallway. This is what's referred to as a dead man's room. The doors to this were closed. That room looks pretty good. The windows didn't fail. So here's the rear room, the room of fire origins. You can see it. The chipboard had failed and it had gotten up into the roof, and the joists are pretty well charred. Here's the room where the firefighters were burned. Didn't burn there as long. Here's the stairwell. There's a skylight right above the stairwell. And here we can see that we have bidirectional flow in this window. Hot gas is coming out the top, fresh air coming in low, which in part is what saved the firefighter Weedman's life. Because he got himself to this point, he had his face out the window, his face piece just had a little bit of damage to the side, so he had no respiratory damage. Fortunately, he's burning the hell out of his arm and his leg while he's waiting for the ladder to get to him. So again, we model it looking at the timelines of when the skylights were open, when the scuttle was open. So this is before tactical roof and window ventilation. So the front door's open, so that's our inlet. The flow path comes up the stairs. Our fire is in the bedroom, just it's lined up with this. This is the stair side of the house. This is the bedroom side of the house. We sort of divided it in half. So we're looking at the railroad flats here, the stair here, or the railroad bedrooms here. So the flow's going up and in and over into the bedroom and out the windows. Right, so that's the path of least resistance. That's the preferred path of travel. And then here are the skylights, and then here are the front windows. So what do you think happens? Well, when you break a skylight, what's going to happen? Now that's an exit flow, part of the exit for the flow path. So the skylights are open, the fire area is getting larger, the fire is coming to the openings, right? You saw it in the video I showed you earlier in the simple room. The fire wants to burn toward where the air is. So it's starting to heat up the conditions in the hallway, so the firefighters in the hallway are bailing out. And we've got two firefighters doing a secondary search in this room. They're getting warm. One of them comes out in the hallway on fire. They put a hose stream on him, and he's not burned very badly. He gets out. And Rob Weedman doesn't make it to the door to get in the hallway, and he's hanging out here. And because of the windows are broken, the fire is moving toward them. In fact, it's hotter where there's ventilation as opposed to where there's limited ventilation. Right, because that's where the burnings occurred. So we showed this to the staff chiefs at FDNY, and they asked us to go back and try a number of different variables. Where what happens if we didn't break this window? What happens if we didn't break that window? What happens? Bottom line is the less ventilation, the less heat. So anytime there was less ventilation, it took longer for the fire to develop, longer for the heat to develop, or in some cases, the fire wouldn't have developed enough heat to break the window. So again, you know, people drawing fire toward themselves in an effort to try to make conditions better. Flow path concerns are big in a single family home as well. So here we have a wind-driven fire, but I'm going to show it to you with and without wind. So basically, the wind was coming from this direction, 17 to 26 miles an hour. The firefighters entered on side A, on the downwind side. The firefighters entered the front door. And their hose line was abandoned here in the rear, toward the rear of the house. And what's on the back side of the house is a 16-foot wide glass enclosed patio. So that's on the upwind side of the house. We have the victims made their way. They left the line. They made their way here, and that's where their bodies were found. Fire started in the attic. It was well involved by the time the fire department arrived. By the time the homeowners noticed the fire. The homeowners then wanted to save some vehicles, so they opened the garage door. The door between the house and the garage was left open, and the garage door was left open. They got one of their vehicles out of the garage. Fire department arrives. They force entry into the front door, and you can see where the damage pattern basically is the wind is feeding it. There were some holes cut on the roof here, sort of just above the foyer area here. Ladder company cut some vents in the roof. So we modeled it, again, with our fire dynamic simulators. We're modeling the whole house. We're modeling the vent. We're trying to model the fire department actions, where ceiling was pulled, where the vents were cut, where the ignition source is, and the solarium failure. So this version of the model is going to show you what would happen if we vent the solarium and there's no wind. So right now, the garage door is open. The door to the garage from the kitchen is left open, as the homeowners did. The front door is closed. The fire is dropping down from the attic and starting to work its way around the interior of the structure. Anything above red is 500 degrees Fahrenheit or above. The front door is now open. After they open the front door, they kneel in there, masking up and getting their gear on. Engine 26, which were the two victims, now has entered the house. Engine 36 follows behind. Engine 36 didn't get as deep into the house. They started to pull the ceiling. They were trying to flow water up here. So now we have the ladder company up on the roof. And they start cutting holes. But remember, in this simulation, there's no wind. So the roof is vented, and you actually see a decrease in temperature over here in the area where the roof is vented. So think about it, the flow path's going from the front door to the roof vent. Now the solarium windows have failed, so the heat is now moving out of the solarium windows. We have an inlet and an outlet there. We're losing a lot of heat right there. and we have an inlet and an outlet here. So we're sort of short-circuiting the fire a little bit, and things are getting better in the house. This is a big vent, 16 feet wide. What happens when the window panels fail and they're now exposed to wind? So same situation, same fire department actions, but now we have wind hitting the back of the house. The fire's developing again. Door open, front door still closed. The front door's open, the firefighters are now on the porch masking up. Notice how we start getting additional heat once the front door's open. They now enter the structure, they go down the hallway, and get into this rear room where they start fighting fire. When they were last seen by engine 36 as the heat is forcing them out of the house, these guys were still standing. So now the ladder company's up on the roof. They said when they made their first cut, flame came out of the cut right away. They kept cutting, they punched down the ceiling, and when he looked over, he saw about 1 foot of fire coming over the eave. Then he looked again, and he saw 16 to 20 feet of fire coming over the eave. That's when the window failed. So the window fails, the air comes in, and what happens? Well, there's the flow path, right? Coming in here, down the front door. So it's possible they couldn't stay on the line to follow it out because it was just too hot because the line's in the flow path, right? So they got to an area that was cooler. It just wasn't cool enough for them to survive. The flow path was also in this direction. So what's going on in this front hallway? Well, when we have no wind, hot gases are going out of the vent, and we sort of have cool air coming in the front door, providing some protection, some relief, if you will. Once we have wind, that's not there anymore. Flow reversal at the front door. Before glass failure, we've got cold air coming in low. After glass failure, we just have hot gases. We have unidirectional flow coming out of that front door. So what's going on here? I mean, if you send a crew in there on the downwind side on a windy day, right, to a working fire, basically you're saying you're putting their life is depending on whether or not a piece of glass, maybe 3/16 of an inch or a quarter inch thick, fails, right? Because that's going to create this transition. Again, another view of the flow path and where the victims were. They had nowhere to go. They couldn't go this way, it was too hot. They couldn't go that way, it was too hot. And there were security bars on the windows. So their face pieces melted out and they died. Again, you can see the damage is where the flow path was. Here we have Vandalia, and three firefighters lost their lives in this fire. It was in a 10-story building. This is the center of the building. It's got one wing going in this direction, one wing going in the other direction. This is the elevator core. And you see on the downwind side, we have soot-stained windows, and on the upwind side, we have soot-stained windows. The wind is coming on the upwind side. That was the fire apartment, actually, on the upwind side. And we had three firefighters. The last time they were seen alive by somebody, they were in the elevator lobby. When they looked through the window into the corridor, it was light smoke conditions. Not a big deal. And they started to move down the hallway. There was a little old man in this apartment, and he started to get smoke into his apartment. And the way apparently he got rid of smoke in previous times when there was smoke in his apartment is he opened the windows. He's on the downwind side, the low pressure side of the building. So again, hot goes to cold, high goes to low. So what do you think happened when he opened the windows? Additional smoke came as an apartment. So he decided he was going to leave his apartment. And he opened this door, and the door remained open, and he got even more smoke. And so he sought refuge in his bedroom, and he safely rode out the fire. Because the other thing we learn about flow paths is their thermal impact is extremely directional, following that flow. So something broke the windows in the fire apartment. We'll never know what. But Lieutenant Cavalieri, Firefighter Bohan, and Firefighter Bob basically were between the fire apartment and the little old man's apartment. So when these windows failed, this apartment flashed over, and intense heat and smoke came out of the apartment and went in that direction. So they got caught between where the fire was and where the fire wanted to go. Firefighter Bob, the can man, was able to get out of Mayday. There were rescue companies and some private engine companies in the stair. They had just finished getting a lady in a wheelchair out of this apartment, and within less than a minute, the mayday was called, so this lady was not burned. She was treated for smoke inhalation and released that evening. So we know conditions weren't bad. They changed pretty quickly. As these firefighters went to make an attack, they couldn't get out of the doorway because there's a bulkhead door just behind them that was open. That was their practice at the time. The roof man goes, opens the bulkhead door, it stays open no matter what. So the flow split and now started to go over their head. So this is the direction from the fire apartment to where they were trying to advance the line. Eventually, they advanced two lines down the hall, and in reality, the fuel load in the apartment was starting to burn down, and they recovered the bodies, but were unable to rescue. We look at how the apartment was burned. There's a pretty intense fire in there. It burned through the gypboard, got into the foam plastic insulation on the exterior wall. It burned so hot it spalled the concrete ceiling, the deck planks of the concrete ceiling. And so we made a model of it with our fire dynamic simulator. In fact, this was before the fire dynamic simulator even had its name. So the wind is coming from here. The roof man, in his statement after the fire, he said that he saw flames pulsing in and out of the window, in and out of this window. He did radio that there was a high wind condition. And so when this was modeled originally, the thought was that the wind was going up and down, and that's why the flames were pulsing in and out of the window. So you'll see that when the wind blows, we'll have a push of smoke and heat, flames down the hallway, and when the wind stops, it kind of goes back to the fire apartment. So here's our flow path through the little old man's apartment. Right now, this door is not open until after the mayday. Here's the opening for the bulkhead door. The mayday's called, they open the door, and you see how smoke and flames start to enter the stairwell and why they burned several hose companies before they were able to advance the line down the hall. When the wind stops, it retreats. When the wind blows again, it pushes out. So this was many years ago. It was shared with the FDNY that asked for it. It was never really published until 2008, after we did some experiments because we had no way of validating this. This was sort of our best thoughts on it at the time.